Today is we're continuing the brokenness series, and today is over divorce. Now a few announcements today. Please fill out your connection card. There's a lot of different things on there that you will, maybe if I back up, that'll help. I'm hearing myself feedback here. There's a lot of the things on that card that can help you connect to Clough, so please look at them. I know we do this every week, so people get used to not doing them, but please help us out, look at it. Today, after service, is the All Wheels blessing today, so if you have forgotten your vehicle or anything that you want to get blessed, your bike or your stroller, anything that you have that you want to get blessed, please go and come back. We have Gold Star, we have Band Plan, Model Behavior. There's some cars out there that we can vote on. There's some Young Ebay use sale, all different things. So please stay after. Also, a couple more things. New Life Furniture is on July 11th. So if you can help us build some furniture for people that are coming out of homeless. And there's a connection camp. We need some people to help serve. If you can look in your bulletin, there's dates and times. And we need people to help with food, help move people around. If you just look in the bulletin, everything's in there. And the last one announced today is kind of a sad announcement. Some of you guys may have heard that Rosalind is stepping down as our youth director. You should have gotten a letter explaining all this. It is definitely not anything that's wrong or anything that's going on in her life. She really has been here for 9 years. 9 years is a long time in ministry. We're just glad to have her for the 9 years we had. Next steps is Brian Wallace and Pastor Marie and PBRC here at church is going to get together and find out her replacement. If you didn't get a letter, should have got one in the mail explaining all this. If you didn't get a letter, please write on your connection card that you didn't get one, and we'll have one sent to you. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for bringing us here today. Please slow down our hearts, slow down our minds so we may hear your words. Please be with the people that couldn't be here today. Please be with the people that really just need a little nudge to come into church. They pass by every day. And Lord, please be with the people that are putting together our bike blessing. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Good morning. How is everyone? Good. So most of you know, some of you might not, we had vacation Bible school this past week. Monday through Friday. On Friday was our family fun night where families came together and did like a field day. We raised $310 for building blocks for kids. So we are very proud of the kids that were here. We had around 40 children participate. And so on Friday we had 40 children and way more adults than that, so we didn't count them. And the kids all wore their tie-dye shirts today, and some of the volunteers, except for us slackers that forgot. And they wanted to perform a song for you guys, so we're going to invite Lisa and Heather to come up. They were the music directors to get the kids organized and to sing a song for you. Yes, kids come up.
Now there's a crown waiting for me. It is given to those who write with God. The Lord who judges fairly will give it to me on the day he returns. He will not give it just to me. He will give it to all those who are longing for him to return.
And we'll keep the faith as we run.
Well, good morning, all the way from New Hampshire. Well, not really. It's good to be with you this morning as we continue our conversation about brokenness. And this morning, we're going to dive into a conversation about divorce. Easy topic, right? It's pretty widely accepted today in society. We no longer ostracize people at the water cooler. We don't talk about them. At least, that's the way it looks from the outside. But from the inside, divorce is still very painful and very isolating. I know in romantic comedies, they try to persuade us into believing that every divorce can end with funny antics where both sides come to the end of the movie to a holiday party where they both bring their exes and they come and they enjoy this beautiful dinner together and they have this kind of newly painted Norman Rockwell painting and there's this ending scene. Well, however that might eventually become the painting, it doesn't usually start out that way. This is not the club that anyone who has ever lived through a divorce, that's not how they would describe it. Perhaps eventually they might get there, but at first, their picture might look more like a Picasso painting complete with a severed ear. The divorce club is lonely, where sides have had to be created and shame has been dumped with a concrete mixer. It's heavy. It's painful. And before long, anyone who's been divorced is left having to figure out this whole new life. And sometimes you've chosen to be divorced, and sometimes it's been thrust upon you because it's the only way out. And so now you have to figure out this whole new life. A life that you didn't expect. That wasn't the plan. And so you have to figure out a whole new plan. How do you go to the movies alone? How do you cook for less? How do you answer that wedding invitation? Will you go? Where you're going to have 100 questions? The brokenness that a person who has their marriage torn apart, that pain is just immense. And it's heavy. And it can be debilitating. And yet we in the church, instead of surrounding them and comforting them, we're often the people standing there with rocks, throwing judgmental glances, throwing our hurtful phrases at them. We can be hypocritical and nosy. We can even be self-righteous. We often will even use Jesus' own words to hurt people. That's shocking, right? But we'll use these words from Matthew's gospel in chapter 19, verse 3-9. If you want to follow along on the screen or in your sermon notes, Jesus is talking to the Pharisees and this is what the text says. Some Pharisees came to him in order to test him and they said, "Does the law allow a man to divorce his wife for any reason?" And Jesus answered, "Haven't you read that At the beginning, the Creator made them male and female. And God said, because of this, a man should leave his father and mother and be joined together with his wife, and the two will be one flesh. So they will no longer two, but one flesh. And therefore, humans must not pull apart what God has put together. And the Pharisees said to him, then why did Moses command us to get divorce certificates to divorce her? And Jesus replied, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives because your hearts were unyielding. But it wasn't that way from the beginning. I say to you that whoever divorces his wife except for sexual unfaithfulness and marries another commits adultery. Now, when we read this scripture, we begin immediately to begin to pass judgments because it seems very, this is right and this is wrong, right? We begin to draw lines in the sand. The only way for divorce then is unfaithfulness. And so if you have gone through a divorce, if you know anyone who's, you can see that pile of shame that someone is feeling. And you can see why they might walk away from the church. Jesus doesn't allow, it doesn't seem, for them to come in. There's this pain and brokenness. You can see the sharp edges of a piece of clay. But if we looked at the scripture a little closer, we might find out a few things about it. First, let's see where it fits within the whole of Matthew's story. First, let's just know that John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, someone who is very close to, remember he'd been baptized by his cousin, has just been killed for speaking out about Herod's divorce. So maybe the Pharisees are setting him up. They're asking the questions about how he feels about divorce. They want to test him. They want to push his buttons to see what's going to happen here. Who is this guy Jesus, and can we catch him in anything? This is a test. Now, the Hebrew word in this scripture is test. And the only other time that we've seen this previous to this scripture for this word test is when Jesus is tested in the desert. So it reminds us that the last time that he was tested or tempted was by Satan. So there's clearly something that's going on here. There's something that's being tested, that's being pushed, some boundaries that the Pharisees are looking for. The next thing that I think we need to remember when we're reading this scripture is that this is a first century story. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean that the Pharisees, they wanted power. These are a religious group of people. They were rule followers. So if you're a rule follower, you might identify with these Pharisees. They liked all of the rules. They followed the Torah rules, those laws to the nth degree. And Jesus often would fuss at them for this rule following that they did. And the Pharisees, they wanted power. They wanted a savior who would come in and take over and would override the Roman occupation. That is not what Jesus was doing, though. Jesus, that's not the kind of savior that he was. Now, it's also good to remember that men in general at this time period in our history, they were at the top of the food chain, and that women and children were disposable. Really, they were completely disposable. And so what Jesus is actually doing here when he says, wait, the only way that you can get divorced is if there's infidelity. And so he's giving women some protection, because before that, you could write off your wife, you could write her off, and she would be without any resources at all. And so he's giving her some protection. There's this practice that happened all the time. You hear it in the phrase that Jesus says, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives because your hearts were unyielding. You see, they just kind of willy-nillyed if they got tired of her. Remember, people didn't get married because they were in love. They got married because it was convenient. It was arranged beforehand. It was simply an exchange that happened. And so Jesus is protecting those who are vulnerable, those who are outside of the circle. We can see that in the next few verses of this text. There are little children who are being brought to him to be blessed. And there, the disciples are trying to stop it, and he says, no, let the little children come to me. Now, some of us are still stuck on that rule following, right? Well, Jesus said it, right? Jesus himself said it. Yep, Jesus did say it. That's absolutely true. But Jesus also said to love your neighbor, and we struggle with that. Sometimes it's hard to love our neighbor. Jesus said we had to forgive, not one time, but 70 times, seven times for the same thing. So every time that your neighbor does something to you that you don't like, you have to forgive. It's not even a, well, maybe I should. It's a commandment. And Jesus said to pray for those who seek to harm you, seek to hurt you. And those are just three that I can name off the top of my head. There are so many other things that Jesus told us to do that are a struggle for us. And so let's just name it. If we're honest, none of us are perfect. We all fall short of the glory of God, is what Paul says. In other words, we all screw up. We all sin. Remember, serving I now, that's what sin is. And one sin is no greater than another in the eyes of God, because they all hurt. They all cut God at the very core. And why is that? Because God loves us. And any time that we hurt someone else or we hurt ourselves, it hurts God. I have two children. And when one of my children hurts the other, it is painful. When one of my children hurts someone else, it's painful for me to watch. It's painful. But at the end of the day, it's important for us to remember that all of us fall short of the glory of God. Not just the ones who are not divorced, not just the ones who are single. All of us fall short of the glory of God. And none of us have the right clothes to sit at God's table. And yet, we are invited. Our names are on the guest list. We get to go to dinner with God because God loves us so much. We can't even imagine it. And there's not one thing that we can do about it. Imagine that. We are loved that much. And there's nothing we can do about it. And if you add that in the midst of this painfulness of divorce, these sharp edges that continue to bleed and hurt, and the woundedness of divorce and separation, that Jesus sits with us in the midst of that. He understands our pain and our hurt, our loneliness, of not knowing how to move forward. He sits with us there. He puts people around us to help us move into that next place. He helps us to take those next steps. And for those of you who are feeling shame and guilt, I get that. But you have to know that you're forgiven. I know in your head you might be thinking, yep, I know that. But you're forgiven. Deep down, you might not have forgiven yourself. You know, there's that commandment that Jesus said, you have to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Sometimes when we look back, we can see the damage that something like a divorce has done, and we are so ashamed that we can't forgive ourselves. And yet forgiveness is necessary. The people that we've hurt, we have to forgive ourselves for it. And so we have to work on that process of forgiveness. It's essential. And it's part of the mosaic that we make up today. It's part of that process. And so as you arrive today, you were given a piece of this puzzle. And so maybe this isn't your story, but you know someone who is in that process. And so I pray today that as you listen to Bruce's story, that you will begin to pray for those that you know who are struggling and know that there is hope. I want to introduce you to Bruce Moon. He has experienced the shadow side of divorce and the shame and the guilt that comes from being hurt and wounded, but he also knows that there's victory in Jesus. And so won't you give him a warm welcome?
Kind of sticking me right in the face there. Can y'all hear me well? So bear with me. I'm not fond of doing this. I'd almost rather be in a pit of snakes right now than up here talking to you. And I follow Randy's footsteps. I'm petrified of them. Last Sunday, as I sit in the pews, actually, Brother Bill, where you're out at is about where I was sitting last week. And I happened to glance up at the broken sign, and I saw divorce. I'm in trouble. She's going to call upon me, and I'm going to have to speak. It's happening. So let us begin. I'm Bruce Moon, and I was broken by 3 divorces. Let's talk about an introduction to me before divorce. I was raised on a farm in Mount Orb for the first 21 years of my life. My values I learned from my grandparents. I attended the Mount Orb Church of Christ every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. I had 13-year pens. Do you guys remember the pens you used to get? You would have a long chain. I had 13 years of perfect attendance of never missing a Sunday. My grandfather was an elder in that church most of his life. My role models, they were perfect in every way. My grandfather was successful. He started Moon Tractor Sales in Hillsboro, Ohio. Later was a grocery store owner. And later in life, he chose to be a farmer. They were Christians, my family. They were good people. At the age of 3, my father died, and I might add, was a Christian. He was very well known for his faith. And life changed a little bit, but my grandparents made sure that I was loved and spoiled. Very spoiled, right, Jamie? Very spoiled. I should add, my mother was a terrific woman. She impacted me in my life as well. She was from a family of 21 from Somerset or Burnside, Kentucky, actually even Taterville, if you ever heard of Taterville. She was from a family of 21 brothers and sisters. She survived 2 husbands in death and all but 1 sister of the original 21 brothers and sisters. She survived open heart surgery, breast cancer, a hip replacement, and currently she battles skin cancer today. She is a Christian woman who taught Sunday school, served church most of her life. She's a true survivor. In summary, the first 21 years of my life, you'd have to say, were pretty good. I actually was a Christian back then, too. I attended Butler Springs church camp, and I was baptized there at the age of 12. So knowing all that, knowing my background, how did I become broken? So let's talk about leading up to the first divorce. When I entered high school, peer pressure worked on me. I learned to party. I had most people fooled, including my principal. After all, our class motto back then was, sex is free, school's a bore, we're the class of 74. I started going to church less and less. I left Mount Orb and saw the world. I attended UC College in Clifton, lived away from home. I thought my life was pretty good. Well, just that quick, I'm graduating from college with a degree. I'm getting married 2 weeks after college. I know what you're thinking. Yes. My parents tried to stop it. Did I ever tell you that I learned things the hard way? I have a daughter named Kristen that does the same thing. I got proof. It just kind of, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. leading up to the moment. Remember, I have three of them. That's right, before you know it, I'm married. Oh, yeah, we already have two kids. One of them is six. The other is less than two. And out of nowhere, to me, my wife says, I want a divorce. How do you say shock, disbelief, helplessness, sad, lonely, depressed, worried, how am I going to care for my family, ashamed, worthless, resentment, and hate? I learned to hate. What happened to almost 9 years of commitment? Now then, let's lead up to the second moment, another divorce. Remember, I learned things the hard way. Fast forward, 2 years later, guess what? I'm married again. Beautiful wife, beautiful home. I have a stepdaughter. I was living in a brand new life, a brand new home, and life was good for a short while. How short, you might ask? 6 months, I knew I was in trouble. God, where was he? Yeah, I knew God. We went to Easter Sunday every year. We attended church on Christmas every year, same as I did in my first marriage. Another moment in my life happens. I was the victim of domestic abuse. Yes, I was shocked as anyone. My wife had a drug addiction. She was abused as a child, which led to me being verbally abused, mentally abused, physically attacked, spit upon, wrongfully placed in jail. Not once, but twice. Can you say abused, mortified, ashamed, humiliated? These were all new words I associated with divorce. Okay, so moving on to the third divorce. I survived. I guess I had some of my mother's instincts. I'm a survivor. But I wasn't feeling loved or needed or important to anyone. Did I mention I learned things the hard way? Guess what? Marriage number three. I had found true love. I love my wife. I had a new stepson and stepdaughter. We had blended two families perfectly. People actually told us that we were the modern-day Brady Bunch. And to this day, my daughters Kristen and Jessica have a great relationship with Melissa, my ex-wife. Yes, 12 years together, January 3rd, my wife comes up to me and says, I want a divorce. That was three strikes. I'm in the ninth inning of my life. And it's game over. My life was over. Where do I go to from here? There's no place to go, right? I'm in rock bottom. As you could guess, I was beyond help. I'd just turned 50. I was in serious depression. To the point that my children, Kristen and Justice, said, Dad, we don't come visit you anymore. It's too painful. We can't just sit and watch you cry all day. But let's shift the focus here. It wasn't just about me and that divorce. Divorce doesn't just affect the divorcer and the divorcee. It affects the entire family. It affected my two daughters, Kristen and Jessica, to this day, let alone my stepdaughter, Amanda, Alexa, and Trent, my stepson. He dropped out of a football scholarship at Mount St. Joe because of our divorce. It infects the entire family. the grandparents, the ex-in-laws, the uncles and aunts, and so forth. There is no end to the pain. And all I ever wanted was to be like my grandparents. I was carrying, as Marie said in the video, so much guilt. I couldn't live up to the plans that I had for myself. How would anyone think I could recover from this? So, enough of the bad. Thank God I'm past that part, because I don't want to talk about it again after today, I don't think. The next portion of my life. So, there's three strikes. I'm out. You see, I'm 50 years old at that point. And at 50 years old, you start looking back in the rearview mirror. My role models couldn't have been any more perfect. But I couldn't feel that I could live up to my own expectations. I felt that there was no help in sight, but God was still working in me. He said, don't look back. You're not going that way. A few weeks before I was finally divorced the third time, an old friend of mine, one that I would have not guessed would have invited me to church, asked me to attend a service at Eastside Christian. Somewhat like a miracle, it was a miracle. There, I immediately found love from a congregation in a whole new way. God was there. People that didn't know me showed God's unconditional love to me. I was overwhelmed. I was learning what I had missed my entire life was God. He finally was becoming the center of my life again. Lesson finally learned the hard way. I started growing my faith, finding ways to serve. I went to Over the Rhine every Sunday with a group from church and served the homeless. I was finding that serving helped me forget about my pain. I started serving in the church. I became a regular member at Eastside. I started being the greeter at the front door. Later, I was asked to start a small group for singles. And as you might guess, many of you know that sometimes your pain is your ministry, and that's what had happened for me. And then, not only did we do that, but some friends of mine got together, and we created what we call the Highway Disciples. God is in my life. I'm loved. I'm forgiven. I learned the true meaning of grace. One Sunday at Eastside, something special happened. The minister prayed over buckets of tiny Bible verses that were cut up and thrown into that bucket. The prayer was that you would pull something out of that bucket if you chose, and it would have an impact on your life or would help guide you or direct you to someone that needed help. So as that bucket came passed by to me, I slowly pulled out a verse. I pulled out the verse that was Jeremiah 29:11. I wept. For I know the plans I have in mind for you, declares the Lord. They are plans for peace, not disaster, to give you a future filled with hope. That simple verse brought hope back into my life. That little piece of paper is now a permanent sticky note to my heart. God has plans for me. I have hope and a future. I'm not worthless. God is full of grace. He had not left me, but in reverse, I had left him. I had allowed myself to feel guilty. I couldn't forgive myself. As Marie mentioned last week and this week as well, God doesn't stop loving us. We can't change that. It was like a light bulb in my soul was finally screwed back in. I told you I learned things the hard way. So do you see what was missing in my life the whole time? God. It wouldn't have mattered how many times I was divorced, who I was married to. God was not first in my life. I had to seek him first. By doing so, I was able to accept his grace and place my faith and hope in him. So let's talk about me today. How are things different? As my wife Jamie would say, oy! I worked to exercise and grow my faith. I finally attended that Emmaus walk that I had walked away from 6 times. There at Emmaus, I left 3 buckets of guilt and shame at the Emmaus altar, and I embraced grace. And who would I meet there? My roommate, Tim Malling, who helped change my life. I also met the Colemans and many other wonderful men from Clough sitting in this room. Now I dare you to tell me God didn't have plans for me. He was working when I had no idea he was working for me. I read a devotion the other day. It was claiming that we're all slow learners. Often we have to relearn the lesson 40 and 50 times before we actually learn something from it. I'm sure glad that doesn't apply to divorce. Seriously, as we talk about how to live into hope after divorce or any of the other topics that we have listed up here under broken, here are some ways that can help you to move forward with God's help. Remember, we're all slow learners. When problems keep reoccurring, we think, not again? We've already learned that, but God knows better. The history of Israel illustrates how quickly we forget the lessons God teaches us and how soon we revert to old patterns. We need repeated exposure. Don't revert to the old ways. Surround yourself with Christian friends and your faith. Secondly, we have a lot to unlearn. We pick up a lot of bad habits. And those bad habits don't go away overnight. It would be unrealistic to think that would happen. There's no pill, there's no prayer, there's no principle that will instantly cause all those years of damage to be undone. The Bible calls it taking off the old self and putting on the new self. Thirdly, growth is painful and scary. There is not growth without change. There is no change without fear or loss. And there is not loss without pain. Every change involves loss of some kind. Learn to lean on God and your Christian friends. Fourthly, good habits take time to develop. Remember that your character is the sum of your habits. You can't claim to be kind unless you're habitually kind. Your habits define your character. And there is only one way to develop habits that are Christ-like in character. You must practice them, and it takes time. In closing, so how did I enter into another marriage with Jamie Sowers Moon? Well, I like to think that the Colemans had something to do with that, and the Mallings had something to do with that. And from there, Jesus took the wheel. Jamie and I also live by a phrase that she had engraved so thoughtfully on my wedding band. And actually, I found it in her house in the bathroom one day. It just stuck. That phrase is, love like you've never been hurt before. Ryan wrote a song for us about that. It was the basis of our marriage. When we look at that, it translates to letting go of the past. It doesn't define who you are, and extend grace and forgiveness to all that have harmed you. Don't let the past control your future. Holding on to the past hurts, and it will not let you live in the moment. I learned the hard way. I needed to put God first in my life and in my marriage. Don't let that happen to you. In closing, here are your action steps. This is feeling so good. Place your clay piece on the mosaic in front of us right here as a prayer with a name to help with healing. Forgiveness is essential in divorce. If not, the bitterness will eat at your soul. Work through the process of forgiveness. If you need additional resources, use Forgiving Your Family by Catherine Fisher. Thirdly, see victory in Jesus, as Pastor Marie said. Go down to Washington Park with us July 5th after worship and hand out kindness bars and water to those in need. Thank you.